Beth, I've long been intrigued by the power of religion to make people believe a whole constellation of ideas that perhaps to those of us not involved in it seem radical or extreme or frankly absurd. And this is not, these are not isolated cases. This is the majority of humanity are involved in these kinds of beliefs. You've worked extensively in implanting false memories in adults. And so what I'm wondering about is what we can learn from your extraordinary work of implanting these false memories to the capacity of religion to impart beliefs that perhaps the person didn't have to begin with.
Well, I know quite a bit about planting false memories in the mind of an individual about their own personal experience. That's what I've done hundreds of experiments about.
So what are some examples so we can understand specifically?
Well, so for example, I can change memory for the details of an event that actually happened. Mm-hmm. I can, for example, show people an accident, and then I can ask them a question that insinuates that a certain detail was present in the accident. Did you see the broken headlight when there was no broken headlight? Mm. Many people will respond to the definite article, the insinuation that there was a headlight, and they'll say, yes, I did see it. So I know I can add details to people's memories. I can alter details. I can make you believe that a bad guy, you know, ran from the scene of the crime, had curly hair instead of straight hair. This is a piece of cake. But we can also go further, and in our research, we have planted whole memories into the minds of people. Mm. We've made people believe that they did things that they didn't do. Complete memories. You choked on a small object. You were attacked by a vicious animal. You know, some whole very rich event happened to you when you were younger. So I know something about the malleability of memory. And it seems like we can do that in a short period of time. We can do that because we are bringing a seemingly credible source to bear on the subject. But out there in the world of religious beliefs, where you are soaked in a repetition of those beliefs, you're hearing them from lots of other people, people all around you are believing them, it's no wonder that you can indoctrinate people with these beliefs, even if they don't make very much sense.
Right. Let's try to dig into the detail in terms of the mechanism of how this occurs by trying to understand when you implant a false memory of, let's say, a whole scenario, which is good, what are the characteristics that you need in your experiment to make that happen? Repetition, color, length of time, emotion. What is the parameters that you need to be effective in implanting false memory?
Well, it depends. When I want to make a little bit of a false memory, just tinker with an event, have somebody believe that there was a broken headlight at the accident scene when there wasn't, all I have to do is to ask a leading question, to insinuate that this is the truth. I think I'm inducing people to try to imagine the event with that detail present and part of it. And later on, they are remembering the imagined, altered version and responding.
It sounds like the person themselves are really a co-actor in this, that you're priming it, and then the person themselves really have all the internal mechanisms of really reinforcing it in their own selves. You're not pounding it. You're just very subtly enabling the person to do it themselves subconsciously.
Right. If you believe in the subconscious, they're doing it without even being aware of the fact that they're doing it.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
And the ultimate outcome is you've got somebody who is convinced that they experienced something themselves that they didn't really experience. It's all a product of suggestion. We can do it in a fairly short period of time. We can do it in you know, a single 1 hour experimental session. We can do it even more, better, if we can repeat the suggestion. But it's not very hard to do.
Is there a difference in the emotional character to the to the memory, so that if it has high emotion, like being attacked by an animal, versus just an incidental observation in a scene, is one easier to do than the other?
I don't know whether if I were going to plant something emotional versus something a little bit more insipid, whether it would make a difference. But what I can tell you about emotion is, once I plant that false memory in your mind, you can feel as much emotion about it as you would if it were a real memory, your emotional rate, or a real memory about a true experience.
Mm. Once you plant the false memory, say that I was attacked by an animal as a small child, I will now, recalling that falsely, but recalling it, feel the same emotion. It won't be dead emotion. It will be a real emotion as if it really happened.
That's correct. And you'll rate your emotion as high as other people who really were attacked by an animal will rate when they tell about their experience. And interestingly, one group at Harvard studied a group of individuals who believe they were abducted by aliens. Mm. These people who believe they were abducted by aliens were brought into a laboratory situation, hooked up to a whole bunch of physiological measures, their heart rate and so on. And when they're reminiscing about their alien abduction experiences, they feel, you can see the emotion, their physiological emotion. Mm. It's as strong as other people who are recounting genuine traumatic experiences. Mm, mm, mm. So the bottom line here is that expressed emotion, physiological, or your ratings of emotion are not an indication that what you're recounting is an authentic experience.
Not only that, but as you have the emotion when you imagine the false memory, that probably reinforces the fact that it strengthens the memory itself. It's probably a positive feedback cycle.
Well, and I believe that imagination experience is part of the process that gets people to incorporate these.
So now let's apply what we just learned to people who have religious beliefs, which have strong emotions in terms of sin, shall we say, in whatever religion they have, that they do bad things and feel guilty, or the possibility of some very exalted position that they would have, or because they are a believer in whatever religion they are. So those are very powerful emotions, strong guilt or being exalted. And so would that not reinforce the belief that they have?
Well, I'm not sure there's anything wrong with feeling like if you do bad things, you might feel guilty. I mean, that doesn't sound particularly problematic. I mean, there's nothing absurd about it. There are some things that seem a little bit more absurd. If you become a suicide bomber, you're going to, you know, go to heaven and have 70 virgins at your disposal. That seems pretty absurd to me. How is it that anybody could come to believe that and seriously think that it's true? Well, if they are exposed to the message, if they're exposed to it repeatedly, if they're exposed to it with from a high credibility source, if other people around them are claiming it's true and reinforcing the belief, that's how you get people to believe things that seem, on the surface of it, pretty absurd.
Now, are we fair to compare the two? Let's step back, because on the one hand, you are implanting memories of the past, so things that I think I remember. In belief systems, what is being implanted is a belief about something that maybe I haven't seen, but I now believe to be true. So those are different kinds of things, but the implantation process, because I believe that is the case, whether it's 70 virgins or each religion to be sure, has its own a kind of absurdity that other people would think absurd. So I really believe that to be the case, or I wouldn't do the things I do, just as I really believe that as a child I was attacked by a wild animal. And so the belief is the same, but one is different in the sense I experienced the one that you implanted, and the other is something I believe about the external world. Does that make a difference or not?
Well, I've had this conversation with people before, because in the field of psychology, you would call one memory, a personal memory. It might just be a belief about something right. that happened to you. Mm-hmm. But that's in the category of memories and memory distortion. Mm-hmm. The other is what you might call an attitude about the world, or a belief about the world.
Right.
Frankly, I think those beliefs about the world are probably easier to change. If I can do this and affect one individual mind and make you believe you actually had the experience, it's going to be more of a piece of cake to change your attitudes. When I had this conversation once with another scientist, I'll never forget, he said to me, you know, this world is made up of lumpers and splitters. And he said to me, you're obviously a splitter, because you want to keep these things separate, and you're a splitter. But he was a lumper, although he assured me some of his best friends were splitters. And yes, I see similarities in these two phenomena, but I also think of them as a little bit different. But one, I think, is going to be easier than the other.
Yeah, that...
And I'm working on the harder one.
Well, you know, I'm not sure that bodes well for humanity, but it is the way the world is.